Okay, if you don't comment on any other video of mine this year, it's okay, but I really want to hear your views on this video. Inside Rugby. My name is Mark. I'm a Kiwi rugby fan living here in beautiful Cancun in Mexico. Welcome to the channel. If you're a new first-time viewer, great to have you here. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button. It's completely free. But most of all, make sure you make a comment. It's really important to make a comment on all of these videos. But today is very, very special because I want to talk about the future of our great game of rugby. Now, if you live in South Africa, New Zealand, Australia, Wales, England, Scotland, and a lot of other developing rugby nations, then you know that rugby has a problem in your country. And it's not good enough any longer for us to be talking and moaning and complaining about the problems in world rugby. We've got to fix them, and we can't just rely on world rugby as an organization to do that. As rugby fans, rugby supporters, and rugby ambassadors across the world, we have to stand up and make our voice heard. So what I'm doing in this video is I'm putting together a plan on how I think we can improve the game of rugby around the world. And this plan is a very high level plan. It's an overview of an idea that I have, and I'd love for you to comment and share me your opinions on this particular plan. Of course, there's a lot of details that need to go into the plan, but we've got to start somewhere if we want to improve this great game that we all love across the world. So I'm going to go through the plan with you quickly in this video. I'd love you to comment on all of the plan, sections of the plan, ideas of the plan, or just tell me you think it's a load of rubbish and we can move on. Okay, so let's get into it right now. So how do we improve the game of rugby globally? That's the question that I've asked myself over the last 6 months of doing this YouTube channel, because I read every single one of your comments about the games that we've all been watching and the things that have been going on in the rugby world. And I take that information and I put it up here and I think about it and I reflect on all of those comments that you make. So thank you for contributing in that way over the last 6 months on this rugby channel. And with those ideas, I thought rather than just let them percolate in there, I actually want to come up with an idea of my own to share back with you so you can tell me whether or not you think that this idea is good. Now, when you say you want to improve something in the world, it doesn't matter whether it's your own fitness or health or your job or whatever, you've got to actually acknowledge that you've got a problem. And I think we can acknowledge that rugby has a number of problems across the world. Domestic rugby in a number of countries is not going too well at all. We're seeing bankruptcy in clubs, we're seeing players' financial futures being threatened, their livelihoods, and we're seeing the game as far as viewership go down as well, both at stadiums and also online. So we have to create better access for people to access the game and to be able to be more interested. I think also we need to see the best players in the world playing more regularly. Look at the hype and energy we had around the Rugby World Cup, but it's only every 4 years. And then we fall into this pattern of international test matches that last for 3 or 4 months of the year, and then everything goes quiet again. I think that needs to change. We also need to make sure that we protect the welfare more of players and administrators and officials in the game. So yes, we do have problems in the world of rugby, and yes, we can acknowledge those problems before we move on. So let's start with international test rugby, and this is the first area that I would make significant changes to try and improve the game across the world. And I ask you all to try to do this. Imagine a international test rugby season, something like a Formula One season. A season that goes from March to November each and every year. A season that allows us to see the best rugby union players in the world playing against each other on a regular basis throughout an entire season. That's what I'm proposing in my plan. Now, why March until November? Well, I think this gives an opportunity for a couple of things. First of all, it gives teams an opportunity to get ready at the beginning of the year, get their selections and their fitness and their camps together, and then kicking off a competition in March. The competition would go through until November, where we have a playoff series, and I'll talk more about that in this particular video. And there would also be an opportunity mid-season to have a break, so players and teams could take a rest as well. Now, I know a lot of the points that I bring up in this plan are going to be controversial, and some of you are probably going to look at it and just go, that's a stupid idea. Well, I'm working on the basis that no idea is stupid and it can be worked on and it can be figured out. So March until November is the season that I'd like to see us go forward with in international rugby season. Now, who's going to play in those test matches? Well, my theory would be based on a plan that only international test players play in this series, and those international test players cannot play domestic rugby anymore. Yes, I'm freeing up the domestic rugby season for another opportunity, and I'm going to share that later in this video. So we're going to have professional international test rugby players that play a whole season from March through until November, and that's all they do, and they're going to get paid accordingly, and you'll see in this video how I believe that can actually happen. So who's going to play in this international test season? Well, it's going to be a simple two division category. We're going to have teams who are ranked number 1 to 10 in the world in Division 1, and we're going to have teams ranked from 11 through 20 in Division 2. That's who's going to play in the international test series from March through to November. Okay, so what's the format going to be of this competition? Well, it's going to be playing every team twice a year in a home and away series. So the home audience of that nation gets to see their team playing against every team in their division once a year, and they get to play away as well. Now, for the home teams, they can decide obviously on what city they play that particular game in, so they can choose to move the games around the country, their home country, which will obviously be good for the game in their country. Just like in a Formula One season, there'll be a mid-season break for all the teams to recuperate, spend time with their families and loved ones again at a more, a longer period of time, and then reconvene for the second part of the season. So the March to November timeline will be broken up mid-season for all the players, coaches, and everybody else associated with the game and those teams to have a break during the middle of the year. Okay, so how's all this going to be paid for? Well, first of all, the teams are going to get prize money for winning every game that they play, but they'll also get prize money for losing each game that they play, but it'll be ratioed respectively based on winning and losing. Teams will also get points awarded for each win and also for each loss. So by the time we get to the end of the season, teams will have X number of points that they've accumulated over winning and losing for the entire period of the season. Now, talking about the playoffs, each year there'll be an opportunity for two teams in Division 2 to go up to Division 1, and obviously two teams in Division 1 to go down to Division 2. So at the end of the year, Division 2 teams will play against the Division 1 teams based on their points finishing position, and the winners of those games will stay or go up to Division 1. So we end up with 10 teams again in Division 1 and 10 teams in Division 2 for the next season. Now, just like Formula 1, depending on where your team finishes in the rankings over the year will depend on you getting some bonus prize money. That's right. So if your team ends up being ranked number 1 at the end of the year, they will receive the top amount of prize money available for the team rankings, and that will be ratioed off down to position 10 in each division. So that's how the bonus revenue scheme will work for this competition. Now, under this plan, teams will play a total of 18 games a year, 18 test matches. The All Blacks in South Africa are going to be playing 15 test matches this year. But the difference between my plan and what's currently happening is my plan will make sure that these teams play over the period of March through to November. So the season's going to be much longer. It's going to give the teams a lot more time in terms of breaks during the season and opportunities to make sure that logistics planning of flying across the world and playing those games is done in a manner which is going to be humanly possible, and also not allow for too much fatigue to come into players, and also allow time for players to overcome injuries and not miss too much of the season. Now, if we were to have a very lengthy season like this from March through to November, what additional benefits do we think this is going to bring to the world of rugby? Well, first of all, the obvious one is increased revenues. We're going to see the season go for much longer, so sponsors are going to be able to get more exposure through their broadcasting opportunities. So broadcasting revenues will increase significantly by lengthening the season from March through to November. And sponsors are going to get more return on their investment because they're going to be able to get their brand in front of more eyes over an extended period of rugby season throughout the year. That's going to be a great thing. Ticket sales are going to increase because there's going to be more games played, and also the fans are going to be happier because they're going to get to see the best players in the world playing against the best competition on a regular basis. As I said at the beginning of the video, we have to wait every 4 years to really see the best of the best playing each other in a knockout tournament. This is going to give us an opportunity to see the best play the best throughout a rugby season in 1 year. Another benefit that I see coming from this particular plan is that the players involved, they don't need to worry about going off and playing club rugby and making sure that their financial security is involved. This has to be an all-in approach. We don't see Formula One drivers leaving after the season and going and playing for, or driving for a club, do we, around the world? No. We see them being looked after at the pinnacle of their sport, which I believe Test rugby players should be in the game of rugby. So they need to be rewarded accordingly, and that needs to come out of the revenue pot that gets put together for this particular series. Now, part of my thinking around this plan was to make sure that we learn from other sports. If we look at tennis players, the top tennis players, they play on the ATP tour every year. They don't go and play on the Challenger tour or the smaller tours. We see the best tennis players playing regularly on the ATP tour. If we look at golf, they're playing on the PGA tour or the LIV tour, and we know that's going to come together at some stage. And we want to see the best golf players week in, week out. And that's why the tours are having this problem, because they weren't structured properly from the beginning. In cricket, we want to see the best players playing all the time. And this is why one day cricket has caused a lot of problems within the world of cricket, because the test players have to look at playing two different types of game. We don't want to see that happening in rugby union. We don't see all the test players going off and playing rugby sevens. We want to make sure the test players and the legacy and the history of the game, the test game of rugby, is kept. And this is a way of doing that, I believe. Okay, so we've got a season that mirrors a Formula One season going from March through to November for rugby. It's test players only. They're not allowed to play domestic rugby. So the obvious question is, what's going to happen to domestic rugby around the world? Well, domestic rugby around the world today is in trouble. We're seeing a lot of decreasing revenues. We're seeing clubs, particularly in the UK, going bankrupt, and a lot of problems around attendance and access to the game. By putting this plan in place, I think we're going to have a number of positive impacts on domestic rugby. First of all, it's going to become the true breeding ground for younger players to get selected to go up to international level. And without the superstars of Test rugby playing in domestic rugby, you're going to be able to make sure that these younger players get a real opportunity to play week in, week out, to be noticed, to be seen, to be coached properly, and also financially rewarded at a level that's going to make it much more sustainable for these clubs. They're not going to have to pay superstar salaries to keep some of these superstar players within their club rugby system. As a result of that, the domestic rugby club budget can go down, and they can actually look at different ways of sustaining the model. I have a lot of other theories around domestic rugby that I'll perhaps share in another video, but as I said at the beginning of this video, this is a high level plan that I wanted to share with you all today, get your thoughts and opinions on it, and see what ideas you've got on how you think we can improve rugby across the world. So there you go, there's my simple high level plan on how I would fix rugby around the world at the moment. I would create an international test series that mirrors that of a Formula One season, starting from March through to November each year. Those players selected for the national teams would not be allowed to play domestic rugby. They would be full-time professional international test players. This would free up domestic rugby around the world to be a breeding ground only for younger players to come through and try to get selected into these test teams. The revenue system would be increased because of increased broadcasting rights, increased sponsorship opportunities, increased ticket sales at games, more rugby games for fans to see across the world of the best rugby players playing against the other best rugby players week in, week out across the world. That is my plan in a very simple state. Now, I'd love to hear your comments on this plan. What do you think of it? And I saw all the hype around and the energy around the Rugby World Cup in France last year, just like you did. And then I saw how that energy gets drained after the Rugby World Cup and everything goes quiet. I want us to see whether we can create that hype around the game of rugby through the entire year so that we get spectators, sponsors, investors involved in the game to really keep it top of mind and to become a dominant force in the world of sport. There's no reason why rugby can't be like football, Formula One, and a lot of other great sports around the world in terms of viewership and in terms of revenue numbers. Okay, well that's it for my particular video. I hope you enjoyed it. I want to hear your views and opinions. So I'll go away, do the editing now, and sit nervously waiting to hear your comments and views on this particular plan. Thank you very much for watching my channel. It's very easy to do. It remains a free process in your life. All you have to do is hit that subscribe button. Give this video a thumbs up if you think I'm doing a little bit of work to try and help the world of rugby. And I'll see you again soon with another video. Until then, take care, stay safe. It's time to say adios from here in beautiful Mexico. Bye for now.